when I approach a mix, I really think about the intent of the song. You know, I put up the faders, especially if I haven't heard the song before. I'll push up all the faders and get a rough balance to sort of feel out what the band were thinking, what the artist was thinking about, and what the primary, like, motivating force is and the primary emotional sort of journey that this song is going to go on. Wes and Jer's songs are like, you know, cinematic, the way they put these things together. It's all about the vocal. Everything is about the vocal. And you'll notice it's really loud and it's really wet. So that's like sort of the defining characteristic of their recordings and of the way they wanted me to mix this song. Like, I mixed it the way I wanted to, and then it's like, more vocal, more vocal, more vocal. Make the vocal louder, louder. And I'm like, really? Really? And then it's like, oh, okay, I get this now. And after the first couple songs, it's like I just knew where that vocal needed to sit. In my studio, so I'm looking at you, but behind the camera, I have this post that my monitor sits upon, and I imagine the singer's head being on that post. And if the singer's head is not on that post, then I haven't done my job yet, because the singer's got to be way up in front, particularly on this record. Like, he's actually up here as opposed to down there. But most records, the singer's there. And on this one, he's just a bit more godlike. And that's sort of the phrase we were using when we were thinking about these mixes. So the vocal has to be clear, but at the same time, it's, you know, he loves that reverb sound. So there's a balance between trying to make every word enunciated so you can hear it on any speaker, on any set of speakers, any radio, and having that space come across, that sense of not quite being in a well, but, you know, something that's just, that's beautiful, and there's like this fog on the ground, you know? It's this incredible feeling of space around the vocal. So that was the mission in all these mixes. And, you know, to me as a rock guy primarily, I want to make sure it's still moving, that there's energy to it, that there's this locomotion to anything else that can possibly help propel the song along. You know, we've got that acoustic guitar that's strumming along the entire time. We've got piano chords, and then, you know, we get the percussion coming in later. The bass helps move things along. So everybody's got to pull their own weight. There was a lot of very intentional thought about each particular part, when it was going to come in, when it was going to play, what it was going to play, like how fancy it was going to be, how sparse it was going to be. And each of those decisions made along the way informed the next decision. So it was like, it wasn't like a collection of stuff, like let's pile a bunch of crap on the song and sort it out later. It was like, I don't know if the bass should come in there. I think it should come in a little later. And we'd, you know, we'd play it from the top with the bass coming in a little bit later. It's like, okay, that's the way it is. Cut the bass out there. Done. Okay. Do we still have a song? Yes, of course we have a song because we've got the acoustic guitar and the vocals. Okay, well, that's the next instrument. Well, we need piano because it's a piano band. So, all right, where does the piano come in? We played with that and came up with a solid arrangement of where all these things were going to come in. Okay, drums, so on. Everything was very, very intentional, particularly with this song. There was an interesting process behind this song. My goal was to help that along and make it this, like, you know, again, godlike, cinematic kind of song.